Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to First United Methodist Church. My name is Laura Sambrick. I'm the associate pastor here. I'd like to draw your attention to the Connect card. Let us know you're here and how we can be praying for you. Today, we continue in our sermon series, God and You. Next week, we're going to be talking about God's day and your time. Yesterday, we had a service for our friend Linda Cullen. We're continuing to pray for her husband Paul and his family. On Saturday, February 4th, we will be having services for Paul Belzer. That's in 2 weeks, on Saturday, February 4th. So praying for their family. Next Sunday, we will be commissioning our mission team leaving for Sierra Leone. That includes Pastor Joe and four of our church members, and they are going to be visiting Dorcas Commanda's mission, Mama Land Village, and seeing about the progress that they are making on that community center that we gave money for. So that's going to be so exciting, and we can't wait to hear reports back from their mission trip. Also on February 4th at 11:30 is a family Valentine's Day event. And I am telling you, we've gotten such a tremendous response to this event. We have about 100 children and their parents coming to this event. So that's a little more than we thought. We're so excited. Yeah, I know, it's so great. So we could really use your help. If you are free that day to be a greeter, to hand out crafts, to just maybe do crowd control, we would love for you to come, and you're gonna make friends. These are people from our community that are coming to have a fun time with their family. So if you can help in any way possible, please use the Connect card and sign up. Let us know that you can help, and we'll find an easy way for you to get involved. Another important family ministry here at First Church is our Discovery Corner Preschool, and we are selling sub vouchers in the gathering place the next 3 weeks to S. Clyde Weaver. So they're $7, and the good thing about that is you purchase the voucher and you go get your sub at a time that's convenient for you. You don't have to eat them today, you know, whenever it works for you that you don't want to make dinner. So support the preschool by purchasing these vouchers. Please stand as you are able and join me in our call to worship. Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong of their strength, or the wealthy of their riches, that they understand and know God, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth.
Thank you. seated. Let us join our voices in the common prayer as found printed in the bulletin. God, our judge and savior, teach us to be open to your truth and to trust in your love. Help us always speak in truth in love, and to be patient and gracious towards others as you are with us. Grant that we may live each day with confidence in your mercy and gratitude for your saving grace through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Wow, that was beautiful. Thank you, Carol Choir. Thank you, Jan. Amazing music, as always. Right now, I'd like to call any other kids that are out there to come up for this children's message. Come on up. So what do we do sometimes when we have to make a difficult decision or a tough choice? Sometimes we might flip a coin. Sometimes we might use a fortune cookie. Does anybody ever use a fortune cookie? Yeah, you like fortune cookies? You open it up, it gives you a nice message that might help you try to make a decision of something you need to do. Sometimes you might use something like this. What is that? An eight ball. You might have a decision to make like, do I want to get on the computer and play video games with my friends, or should I do my homework? You might turn that over and see what it says. What does it say?
Don't bet on it.
What is that again?
It says don't bet on
it. Don't bet on it. Or you might have to do eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Has anybody ever done eeny, meeny, miny, mo before? You might have it might be a Friday, and you have two friends to ask that asked you to come over and play this weekend, and you can't do both, so you can only choose one. You might say, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a tiger by his toe. If he hollers, let him go. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo, I'm playing with Addie. So, what should you do when you have to make an important decision? What should you do, Isaiah?
Read the Bible.
Read the Bible. Good, yes. So, in the Bible, God says, Addie, if I can grab this, can you stand up and hold that up? And Mila, can you read what that says?
Seek and you will find, ask and it will be given to you, knock on the door and it will be opened to you. Matthew 7, verse 7.
Thank you. You can sit down. Seek. Seek. Rebecca, can you stand up and hold that? The first thing we should do when we have a decision to make is to look for the answer. Where should we look? The Bible. I think the best place to look is in the Bible. Rebecca, you can sit down. Ask, right? You want to stand up? The next thing we should do is to ask. Ask when we have an important decision to make, and we should pray about it. Olivia, you want to stand up? Knock. We will face many doors of opportunity in life. When there are several doors and we don't know which one to choose, we should knock on the door and wait to see if God opens it. If it's what is best for us, God will open the door of opportunity for us. Thank you. So how should we face important decisions? What should we do, Isaiah? Hold that Bible up. Yeah, that Bible right there is where we should go to face important decisions, and God will open the door for us if it is something that is good that we are asking for and we need help for. So let's pray about that. Dear Lord, thank you so much for all these beautiful children, and help them to know that you are the person to turn to, that you are the person that they need to seek to find the answers, that you are the one they need to ask. And if it is something that is good for them and they knock on the door, you will open it and you will help them and you will open up all these opportunities for them and just help them to know that you are their rock and you are who they should be leaning on. And that's for everyone in here now. Thank you, in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
The scripture reading comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 to 24. Hear the word of the Lord. But we appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to respect those who labor among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. Esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all of them. See that none of you repays evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to all. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not dispense the words of or despise the words of the prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's anthem is titled The Last Words of David and takes as its text King David of Israel, reflecting on his rule at the end of his life. Comes from 2 Samuel 23rd chapter. It was commissioned by the Boston Symphony Orchestra about 70 years ago in honor of the 25th anniversary of their director, a man who had authority and power to select music, to rehearse the orchestra, and to direct them in performance. Since that time, it's been sung regularly at the installations of people of power, governors and presidents of colleges, pastors, people installed in positions of power. Its text says, he that ruleth over men must be just. We'd broaden that to say anyone who rules over people must be just, ruling in the fear of God, and he'll be like the light of the morning when the sun rises, even a morning without clouds, like the tender grass springing out of the earth by clear shining after rain. David reflecting on what kind of person is in power. Today, we attach this to the text of the morning that Pastor Joe will preach on, coming from the Sermon on the Mount, about how we make decisions, all of us. So this anthem takes the last words of King David speaking about people in power and applies them to each of us individuals in the places where we have judgments to make and where we have power over others. Hear the word of God.
Must be just.
Let us prepare our hearts for prayer. Would you pray with me? Father, it is good to be in this place again this morning, to sing your praises, to worship you, to learn from your word, to fellowship with friends and family, to tell you we love you. Father, today as we begin another busy week, we don't know what lies ahead, but you do. We ask that you would prepare our hearts for the week that is to come. Gracious God, you shepherd us by still waters and guide us along paths of justice and peace. You send your comfort and courage to relieve our tears and fears and the shadows even of death. We offer our praise in love and loyalty, for you are always with us. You are always with us. We remember before you today people living face to face with illness and suffering, for those waiting for diagnosis or treatment, those struggling with disability or delay in medical attention, and those who know grief or fear. God, speak to us a word of healing. Embrace us with your love. We ask for comfort in their time of loss, for the friends and family of Linda Cullen, for Bonnie Belser and family, for Daniel and Brittany Cherry Buffenmeyer and Doug and Carol Cherry. We ask for healing for Meg Jackson and the newborn triplets. May they grow strong, Father, especially little Mara. For Polly Pierce, Joyce Kohler, Teresa Henning, Sandra Castleman, Cheryl Sanders Nilsson, Chip and Kathy Sanders, Chris Smith, Julie McGovern, and Tom Eshelman. Father, we remember Blakely Eister in hospice care. Be with him and his family. Remember before you today people living face to face with economic uncertainty, those struggling with rising costs of living, those who have lost their jobs, maybe even their savings, their homes or business. Provide for their needs. Make a way for them where there seems to be no way. We remember before you today people living face to face with war and violence. Bring peace and unity, justice and mercy in your fragile creation. As the followers of Jesus, give us the courage to unite not only in prayer, but also in action for the needs of the world. Strengthen us to work together so others may see what it means to follow you. And we pray all this in Christ's name, and we join in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may be seated. My text this morning is from Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 to 6. You are welcome to look it up and follow in your pew Bibles on page 6, and all of our folks joining us online, of course, you're welcome to follow along on your home Bible as well. The words of Jesus from the Sermon on the Mount: "Do not judge so that you may not be judged. For the judgment you give will be the judgment you get. And the measure you give will be the measure you get. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' while the log is in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. Do not give what is holy to dogs, and do not throw your pearls before swine, or they will trample them underfoot and turn and maul you." These days, many people in our society, and even some within the church, have enormous doubts about the moral authority of the Bible, the Scriptures. Quoting biblical texts or themes, even tracing them throughout, to address various questions, whether it's about marriage or war and peace or issues of justice or even tithing and giving, will almost always invite some disagreement. So very few people today will accept without question some principle based on quoting a single biblical verse, except one. The one I just read from Matthew 7. "Do not judge." Or as it's put in the old King James Version, "Judge not lest ye be judged." That particular verse still has a lot of currency in society today. All that is needed to render someone silent or become defensive is to say, "Are you judging me?" Or, who are you to judge? Did Jesus mean to prohibit all judgment, or just certain kinds of judgment? Is it possible that there are some kinds of judgment we're not only permitted, but commanded to make? This morning we continue our series, God and You, to try to connect the language and worship of Sunday with the business of life Monday through Saturday, and we're going to wrestle this morning with this whole business of judgment and judging. Now, there is no question that when we render judgments, we can often get ourselves in trouble or get led astray. There's a story you may have heard that actually came from Stephen Covey's classic book, The Seven Habits of Highly Successful People. Covey relates being on the New York City subway one day in the quiet car when a man and his children boarded the car, and the kids began to run and shout and even try to grab things from the passengers. The father, however, sat with his eyes closed and did nothing. Covey became irritated and angry at what seemed to be this man's poor parenting skills, and finally said, "Do something to control your children." The man then revealed that he and they had just come from the hospital, where his wife, the children's mother, had just died. And Covey realized that he did not have all the facts to make an appropriate judgment about what was before his eyes. And when he found out, he said, "I saw things differently, I thought differently, I felt differently, I behaved differently." The problem with so much of our judging is that we just don't have enough information to render a fair judgment. And yet, despite that, we do it all the time. We may hear a story in the news. There's been a police shooting, or there's been a riot, or there's some claim of a new scandal coming out of Washington, and from hundreds or even thousands of miles away, within minutes, and with just a few facts in hand, we pick sides. We make judgments about who's guilty and who's innocent, who's right and who's wrong, who's good and who's bad. Even though we know that the first news reports almost always get something wrong, and certainly don't have a full picture yet. Socrates once is said to have observed, "He who only takes a few things into account finds it easy to pronounce judgment." But does that mean that all judgments are absolutely prohibited? There are other places in Scripture which seem to actually command certain kinds of judging. In 1 John chapter 4, we read, "Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world." Now, clearly, this calls for making judgments. We might prefer the term using spiritual discernment, but still, we must judge between a true prophet and false, between a good spirit and a bad. Another area has to do with the promotion of justice. Proverbs 31:9 says, "Open your mouth, judge righteously, defend the rights of the poor and the needy." Deciding when there is an injustice that needs to be addressed or people that need to be lifted up also requires making judgments about what's good and best and right and true. And there's a passage in John's Gospel, chapter 7, where Jesus is disputing with the religious authorities about right and wrong behavior on the Sabbath. And at one point, Jesus says this, "Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment." So that suggests there is a good kind of judgment, a righteous judgment, as well as a bad or inappropriate kind of judging. You know, this word that is translated to judge, do not judge, has a range of meanings. It can mean to distinguish, to discern, to reach a decision, as Faith was talking about with the children. In a judicial setting, it can mean to render a verdict, to condemn, to hand over for punishment. And there's a range of meaning for our English word as well, is there not? To have good judgment, or to be a person considered of sound judgment, that's a good thing. To be judgmental, however, is a bad thing. I like the exchange recorded in a courtroom between an attorney and a witness on the stand. The question was, "Well, sir, judging from your answer on how you reacted in the emergency call, it sounds like you are a man of intelligence and good judgment." And the answer, "Thank you. And if I were not under oath, I would return the compliment." Seems like both kinds of judgment were in operation there. But the point is that there are judgments we are required to make. Author Lewis Smedes wrote this: "Common sense suggests that if no one ever judged other people, there could be no real human community. In a sinful world, no community can exist for long where nobody is ever held accountable. No teacher would grade a student's performance. No citizen would sit on a jury or call a failed leader to account. And when you come to think of it, nobody would ever forgive anyone for wrongs. We only forgive people for what we blame them. And we blame them only after we have judged them." So Jesus is not prohibiting all judgment. In fact, toward the end of our text that begins with the words, "Do not judge," he says this in verse 6, "Do not give what is holy to dogs, and do not throw your pearls before swine." Now, I think that is a sort of colorful and exaggerated way of saying that we need to practice discernment when it comes to sensitive and valuable things. Things like talking about your faults and theirs, the logs and the specks of sawdust in our eyes. That's not easy stuff to talk about. Some people can't handle it. And some people can't be trusted with the information. So you have to be discerning who you talk to about what. Or to use Jesus' intentionally exaggerated language, you have to make a judgment about who is a dog and who is a swine. And then just a few verses later in chapter 7 and verse 15, Jesus says this: "Watch out for false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them." Again, calling for discernment, for a good kind, a righteous kind of judgment. So making judgments is not an inherently bad thing. And we all know that. I'm sure there are people in your life that you would entrust with things that are most precious to you, even the lives and welfare of your children. And then there are people you wouldn't trust with your laundry. And that's okay. A couple of weeks ago, I mentioned having watched the TV series Breaking Bad about a teacher who descends into evil as a drug dealer. And I said that I thought it was a remarkable Hollywood case study in the doctrine of original sin, how any of us can go terribly bad. Well, one of the interesting and most powerful scenes occurs featuring one of the drug makers. His name is Jesse Pinkman. He goes to a Narcotics Anonymous meeting, and the leader begins the meeting by emphasizing that there is to be no judgment, just total acceptance. So Jesse confesses to killing his dog. And as he tells the story, it's not because the dog was sick or there was no other option. He just killed him. The others in the group begin to murmur and begin to feel outraged, and the leader says, "Hey, we're not here to sit in judgment." And then Jesse, the perpetrator, says, "Why not? The thing is, if you just do stuff and nothing happens, what's it all mean? What's the point? I should stop judging and accept no matter what I do. Hooray for me, because I'm a great guy. No matter how many dogs I kill, I just, what, do an inventory and accept? If you backed your truck over your own kid, you accept?" And the leader says, "Hey, Jesse, I know you're in pain." And Jesse says, "No. You know what? Why am I here in the first place? It's to sell you meth. You're nothing to me but customers. Are you okay with that? You accept?" And the leader says, "No." And Jesse says, "About time." Sometimes we need to say no, not because it's unhealthy or will make you unhappy, but because it's wrong. Because there is right and wrong under God, and we are accountable to God and to each other. And that's why exercising a righteous judgment is good news, not bad. When sin is identified as sin, it can be confessed, it can be repented, forgiven, overcome. Is that not why Jesus came? To address our sin, not just deny it, ignore it, accept it, but confront it, atone for it upon the cross, and give us the power by His Spirit to overcome it. In John's Gospel, chapter 3, we read this: "This is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil." That verse, which names humanity's love of evil, comes right on the heels of our favorite verse from John's Gospel, John 3:16-17. "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God's righteous judgment against our sin, our evil, did not prompt God to condemn humanity, but rather to act to save us. And I think that leads to a critical point. Judgment that is good and right is always designed to bring about healing, or justice, or the restoration of relationship. It's not just for the fun of casting moral thunderbolts. In our text, Jesus talks about removing the log from your own eye so that you can see clearly to remove the speck from your brother or sister's eye, your neighbor's eye. It's actually brother in the text, a word the early church used of one another because they thought of themselves as God's family called to love one another. So even in our text, Jesus suggests there is a time, after much self-examination and self-correction, to focus on that speck in the brother or sister's eye, because we're supposed to love each other. And real love cares enough to tell the truth. I hope you would love me enough that if you saw me going down some dark path or begin preaching some bizarre, strange, unbiblical doctrine, you would speak to me about it. Try to get me right back on the right path. That requires using sound judgment in love with a desire to help, not to condemn. So I think a primary characteristic of appropriate or righteous judgment is that it's done in a spirit of love with a view towards helping, towards healing. Well, there's another characteristic of appropriate judgment. That is that it focuses on actions and attitudes, not persons. You know, there's that old saying that has fallen into disfavor for some reason, love the sinner, hate the sin. Remember that? For some reason, that's not cool anymore to say. It's too bad, because I think it carries an important distinction. It seems to me that an awful lot of our interactions in society today are getting nastier and more judgmental, not less. There's a tendency, especially in our public debates, to regard others with whom we disagree not just as wrong, but as evil. And so disagreement descends into name-calling, condemnation, ascribing dark motives. And that's often because we don't distinguish between the sin and the sinner, the act and the actor. So someone does something wrong or says something terrible, and we condemn them entirely. We cancel them even. Earlier in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus has said that calling someone a fool is enough to put you in danger of hellfire. Why? Because whenever we condemn someone in some absolute way as hopeless or worthless or somehow beyond the grace of God to be able to redeem, we're essentially denying Jesus himself and what he came to do. And we're also denying our own sinfulness. Perhaps the most important characteristic of appropriate judgment from our text is that it is applied first and foremost to ourselves. Jesus says, first, look at the plank in your own eye and be very careful that you don't apply standards to others that you do not first and ruthlessly apply to yourself. Verse 2, in the same way you judge others, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. I'm sure you remember the story of the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8. And even in our very confused society today, it seems adultery is still something we all agree is a bad thing, breaking your marital vows. And in those days, it carried the death penalty. A group brought this woman before Jesus, said she was caught in the very act, which leads to a question, where's the guy? But that's another sermon, perhaps. And so they pick up stones to kill her, to put her to death. Well, Jesus does not accept her behavior. He does not just say, oh, it's okay. He does later say to her, go and sin no more. But he also rejects the condemnation of the crowd. And he says to them, the one who is without sin should cast the first stone. You know, it's been said that most of us judge others by their actions, but we want them to judge us by our motives. We meant well. I couldn't help it. I was overcome. So I think we have a call here to be generous in our judgments. to practice the golden rule. Do unto others as we would have them do unto other, to us. Would we want other people calling us a jerk or an idiot? Would we want others dismissing us or condemning us behind our backs? Or would we want others most of the time to defer judgment and to be patient toward us? What Jesus is prohibiting, dare I say what Jesus is judging as wrong, is a critical and judgmental spirit, an attitude of moral superiority. Because ultimately, the distance between us and those we condemn is not nearly so far as we might want to think. In Romans chapter 2, Paul says, "Therefore, you have no excuse, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things." Years ago, a Philadelphia preacher named Donald Barnhouse used the image of three men who were cast into the ocean after a plane crash at sea. They're treading water hundreds of miles, many miles, thousands of miles from land. One of them is a pretty poor swimmer and having a hard time staying afloat. Another is a fairly good swimmer. The third is an Olympic gold medalist swimmer. The gold medalist may well judge his two companions to be less than the best swimmers. He might want to give them some pointers on stroke and breathing, but what does it matter in that situation? The poor swimmer might drown in a matter of minutes. The average or good swimmer may last a few hours. Perhaps the Olympian can go for half a day or more. But all of them, in the middle of the ocean, are bound to die. Now, what all of them need is not criticism, not judgment about their technique, not a swim coach. They need a rescue. They need a savior. And so do we. All of us. And praise God, we have one in Jesus Christ who came to deliver us from judgment, the judgment of God that our sins have earned us. Well, practicing appropriate, righteous judgment and not unrighteous or inappropriate, that's not easy to do. You know, this passage about not judging, after all, is in the Sermon on the Mount, the same Sermon on the Mount that tells us to love our enemies, to pray for those who persecute us. The same Sermon on the Mount that tells us that our anger is as serious before God as murder, that our lusts are as bad as our adulteries. The same Sermon on the Mount that calls us to be peacemakers and pure in heart, and even to rejoice when abused for the name of Christ. All of that is tough. None of that is easy to put into practice. It requires a wisdom and a power and a love that is beyond us to even begin to put into practice. None of us will get this issue of judging right, or any other, unless we are living in and out of the love of Christ every day. Ephesians 1 says this: "I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Let that be our prayer, and by the grace of God, as we seek to practice sound judgment, let that be our practice." Amen.
Having heard the word of God read and proclaimed, let us state our beliefs using the ecumenical version of the Apostles' Creed as printed in the bulletin. Please stand as you are able. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. remain standing, and let us join together in our closing prayer as found in your bulletin. Almighty Father, whose Son, our Savior Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of his glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. For he is alive and reigns, now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace and in the power of the Holy Spirit to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Amen.